SLE is a devastating autoimmune disease that strikes people in the primes of their lives. But although we have been familiar with this condition for hundreds of years, scientists have still not determined exactly what the underlying cause of this disease is. A 64-year-old white woman went to see her physician with complaints of fever, malaise, vomiting after eating of several months' duration. She had a history of high blood pressure, for which she was treated with hydralazine and lisinopril, two medications that are used to treat hypertension. She denied any history of fever, sore throat, night sweats, or facial swelling, but since the beginning of the year, she had lost 40 to 50 pounds. All imaging studies done at the time were negative, and the woman was started on medication for abdominal migraine and for her vomiting. Her vomiting eventually subsided, but over the ensuing month, she developed multiple joint pains. At that time, she was also found to have a low white count as well as anemia. Systemic lupus erythematosus, SLE, is a multi-system autoimmune disease that attacks many tissues in the body. The immune system is the defense system of the body that produces proteins known as antibodies, which attach to and destroy invading germs in the body. In autoimmune diseases, the immune system mistakenly attacks the tissues of the body by producing antibodies that attack proteins or antigens in the nucleus of the cell. These antibodies are called antinuclear antibodies, or ANAs. One such antinuclear antibody, the anti-Smith antibody, is an antibody that is produced against the Smith antigen found in the nucleus of the cell. And the anti-Smith antibody is found almost exclusively in patients with SLE, with lupus. Another antibody, known as the anti-double-stranded DNA antibody, is an antibody that is formed against the DNA in the cell. And this, too, is mostly found in patients with lupus. This attack on the tissues of the body leads to inflammation in the joints, the skin, the brain, the lungs, the heart, or the kidneys. And this produces the typical signs and symptoms of SLE. Patients with lupus can present with a wide variety of symptoms, ranging from the malar rash in the cheeks to end-stage renal disease requiring either dialysis or kidney transplantation. Lupus generally presents in younger populations, and 80% of cases occur in patients between the ages of 16 to 55. Lupus occurs more frequently in women than in men, and for some unknown reason, occurs more frequently in African Americans, Hispanics, and Asians than in whites. Although Hippocrates, who lived from 460 BC to 375 BC, had described sores of the skin, which he called herpes ethiomenos, and Hibernus of Tours had already used the term lupus for a skin disease back in 916 AD, scientists still, up to today, have not discovered what the actual cause of this mysterious disease is. So far, scientists have concluded that SLE occurs in people with a genetic predisposition to disease who are exposed to certain environmental triggers. Environmental triggers include exposure to UV radiation, exposure to silica dust in industrial or agricultural settings, smoking, or certain types of infections. Over the years, multiple studies have shown an association between EBV infection and lupus. Blood testing done on young patients with SLE showed they had 99% positivity for Epstein-Barr virus, EBV, compared to only 70% in those without. lupus. Most people become infected with Epstein-Barr virus by the time they reach age 2. And those infections at that age generally produce mild symptoms and go unnoticed. People who are not infected at that age can become infected during their adolescence, at which time the disease can present as infectious mononucleosis, popularly called kissing disease. Infectious mononucleosis is more serious and can present with symptoms such as fever, malaise, swelling of the lymph nodes, swelling of the throat, skin rash, enlargement of the liver, enlargement of the spleen. But these symptoms usually resolve within 2 to 4 weeks. The virus is spread by saliva or by other body fluids such as blood or semen. Once the virus enters the body, it penetrates the superficial cells known as the epithelial cells, and from there it can make its way deeper into the body where it can enter immune cells known as B cells. After entering the body, the virus takes up residence in either the epithelial or superficial cells, or more frequently in the B cells of the immune system. From here, the virus can reactivate intermittently, causing new symptoms. During infection or reactivation, the virus causes the destruction of cells and the release of cellular debris, which is recognized by the immune system and against which the immune system can generate antibodies. The process by which the immune system recognizes the cellular debris as foreign and generates antibodies against it is probably by molecular mimicry. Molecular mimicry is a process in which the similarity between the antigens and proteins found on the germs entering the body and the proteins already existing in the body causes the body to produce antibodies against the germ that cross-react with the proteins of the body. The Epstein-Barr virus nuclear antigen, EBNA1, has portions in its structure that cause antibodies produced against that antigen to cross-react with the Smith antigen in the nucleus of the cell. As a result, as the immune system tries to rid the body of Epstein-Barr virus, it also destroys the body's own cells. With regards to our patient, although her ANA antinuclear antibodies were negative, she had met the criteria for classification as lupus, SLA. She was therefore started on methotrexate, an immune suppressant drug used to treat lupus. 1 month later, the woman returned and reported that her arthritis had improved somewhat. But over the next month, she developed shallow ulcers in her mouth, worsening gastritis, and her white blood cell count fell to dangerously low levels. The doctors immediately stopped the methotrexate and ran some more blood tests, which were positive for antinuclear antibodies at that time. They also performed testing for the Epstein-Barr virus, known as the viral capsid antigen, immune globulin M and immune globulin G, and the Epstein-Barr virus nuclear antigen, immune globulin G, all of which were positive. These tests suggested that the woman was recently infected with Epstein-Barr virus. These results prompted the doctors to diagnose acute viral arthritis and to prescribe anti-inflammatories, non-steroidal anti-inflammatories, for her joint pains. 5 months later, the woman returned for follow-up, and by that time, had developed swelling in the joints of the hands as well as in both elbows and the right knee. The woman's anti-double-stranded DNA antibodies were still negative at that time, but she was, however, started on hydroxychloroquine and prednisone. After a few weeks on hydroxychloroquine, her joint pains had stopped, the sores in her mouth had disappeared, and her low white blood cell count and anemia had returned to normal. Although these findings do not prove that EBV, Epstein-Barr virus, was the cause of this woman's SLE, her lupus, all appearances are that this is exactly what happened. Thank you for watching. I hope you found this video useful and informative. If you did, like and share the video with your friends and family and subscribe to the channel. It makes a huge difference and allows us to continue to bring you useful information in medicine. I hope to see you soon in the next video. Take care.